Hey, what's up, you guys? So today I'm going to be discussing A Reaper at the Gate by SABAA TAHIR. So this is the third book in the An Ember and the Ashes series, and this book so far was my favorite by far. This book I felt like had the best beginning out of all of the books so far. It was very gripping, and I was so curious to see what was going to happen next, and I was so stressed out for the characters the entire time. I honestly loved how the beginning kind of set up our characters all four separate journeys that would somehow coalesce, and so I honestly really loved that because I was just excited for them to develop each individually as characters. I do know that in my past book talks, I've talked about how their relationships, I don't feel like they're developing enough, but I think that by separating them, SABAA TAHIR is actually doing their relationship justice because it's giving them a chance to kind of be separate people before we kind of put them together, and it's giving like a strain on the relationship because when you put distance in there like that, it causes strain, which is what you need for development. As I said before at the beginning, there was just so much more direction with it. I felt like I knew where the plot was going to go a lot sooner. I thought that I got an exciting incident so much sooner. I just loved how we knew where this was going to go, even if we didn't know exactly how we were going to get there. I loved that there was actually a prophecy in here that we got to kind of pick apart and figure out what it means as the story was going along. I'm always here for a good prophecy. Percy Jackson has some good ones. This book in particular had a fantastic one, so I absolutely loved that aspect of the beginning, and I think that's part of what made the beginning of this book so strong. I also feel like we are starting to see a lot of character development when it comes to Helen. She really changed a lot in this book, and I feel like she is really growing to be someone very different. I think she's going to grow into being a very good leader. I honestly think that at the end of this series, she is going to be the one in charge of the Empire, and I am so excited for how this book ends in regards to Helen and Lya and how they are going to start to work together a little bit. So I'm excited to see how that's going to play out now that's going to work. I also liked how in this book our villains felt very threatening, especially in regards to the commandant. I feel like she actually did things in this book. I feel like I was constantly questioning what her motives were, what her goals were, what she was trying to accomplish, and I honestly loved that. And I loved how we got to see her actually accomplish things. We got to see her actually make moves. We got to see her be a power player in this book, and I was here for it. It made the conflict feel so much more intense. I also loved the Nightbringer in this book as well. I feel like we got so much more development with him, and it's really making me question who is the good guy here, because I understand where the Nightbringer is really coming from. I really do, because his people were very wrong. Like, they were very, very, very wrong. And so it's just kind of a question of what do you do in that circumstance? And I feel like this is just a lose-lose situation no matter what. There is no way for everyone to be happy, and sometimes you just have to right a wrong. So I'm really excited to see how his story is going to transition into the next book, because this book, it really shook him up for me. It made me really question what I believe and what I think about goodness and badness and what really is bad, because I don't know if I think that the Nightbringer is a bad person necessarily. He's just a hurt one. I'm so curious to see what's gonna happen with him, what's gonna happen with his people, what is going to happen in general with the djinn in the next book, because this book has set them up for such a great conflict in the next book. I'm excited to see growth and development, and I'm hopeful that everyone at the end of this can have some form of happiness, even if I don't think that's possible at the current moment. So I'm curious to see what's gonna happen in Sky Beyond the Storm. I really need to pick it up because this book, it just ended at such a fantastic moment in the story where everything feels lost, but there's still hope because there's still life. And there is hope in life. I also feel like this book, it was just so emotionally gripping. The other books, they had emotional moments, don't get me wrong, but this book, it gripped me emotionally. I was here for the characters. I was here for their struggles. And I wasn't just here for our good guys. I was here for our bad guys. I want to know more about them. I want to delve in deeper. I want to understand more about them. And I'm so, so excited, honestly, about the villains. Like, this book, it was a shiner for the villains, okay? Like, that's what I think this book did so well. As well as with the beginning. And as always, SABAA TAHIR, great endings to her books, so, and great middles. Like, she does build conflict really well throughout her books, so that stuff, all the same, all really good. But the stuff that she didn't do as well in the other two books, I think she really improved upon and did so much better in this book, and I think this book just shines so much more for it. So, some stuff that I did not like about this book, I did not like that it ended. I could honestly read, just keep going. That's what I want to do right now. I just want to pick up A Sky Beyond the Storm, but I don't have it yet, so, depression. I also did not like so much Moth. I did not get as much development from that particular aspect of this book as I would have liked to. I'm not sure if I should consider Moth a character, a being, an entity. Like, I don't know what I should consider Moth to be. I kind of consider it to be almost a godlike presence, but I don't know if that's what it is because I just don't feel like we got enough definition there for that particular being. And I don't know if we're going to see development from that being or if we're not supposed to see development, if it's supposed to be stagnant, if it's supposed to be flat. Like, I don't know exactly what that is. So I'm curious to see how that is going to go in the next book, how that's going to be incorporated in the next book, because I just don't know yet what it is. Like, I don't have an idea yet. I also wish that we had started to get a little bit more development of the actual djinn. I feel like we got great development with the Nightmare. I wish that as far as his people are concerned, the djinn, we had started to see a little bit more development with them, a little bit more about where they're at now, not so much where they've been, but how they are doing now. You know, we know that they don't really like scholars, understandable, but I want to kind of understand where their headspaces are now. Do they want to be cruel? Do they want to go back to how they were? Like, what do they want? What are their motives? Where are they headed? I think we are going to get some of that next book. I mean, we're probably gonna have to, but in this book, I just wish we had gotten a little bit of a taste of that. I feel like we got a few scenes that really showcase what their goals are gonna be, but I don't feel like we got enough to really get that little taste in our brains of like what we think is gonna go down, because I have my suspicions, but I don't think that they are concrete enough for me to feel really happy with how this book used the djinn as far as where they are at currently in their present time and not just in their past, not just where they came from, not just who they are and what their purpose was, but like, what is their purpose going to be going forward, especially in relation to the fact that Elias is still going to be there. So just curious to see what's gonna go on with that. I loved in this book, I forgot to mention this earlier, but I loved in this book the augurs. I loved how we got more development with them, and I love how I now understand them, where they come from, who they are. I was so shocked with the augurs. So augurs were done fantastically in this book too. I think that this book just did so well with the world building as far as building up our past with this world. I feel like I've got such a better understanding of it, and I'm so glad about that. Another thing that I didn't like was some of the newer characters that were introduced. I don't feel like I got enough of them. I don't feel like I got enough of an understanding as to what was going on there, specifically with the beekeeper, Musa, him and his wife and that stuff. I just didn't get enough of what was going on there. I would like to get a better picture of that hopefully in the next book. See if I can get some development there. Hopefully we can figure out, you know, what is causing the issues that are going on in that location where he is. You'll have to read the book to kind of find out what I'm talking about, because I'm being hella vague. Sorry about that. But that's kind of another thing that I was not the biggest fan of. So now that I've talked about things that I didn't like and things that I liked, if you want to know what this book is about, you kind of have to know what A Never in the Ashes is about, because this is the third book in a series. You can't just start with the third book, start with the first book first. So you can check out my An Ember in the Ashes book talk to get a little bit more of an understanding as to what that book is about. I realized that this was way late and after I've already given you the things that I liked and didn't like, but I forgot to do it sooner and I suck at editing, so I'm probably not gonna move this where it should be. Sorry. So now let's get into the spoilers. Again, I'm not going to go in any particular order. I just kind of listed out some scenes, some things that I wanted to talk about. So that's what I'm going to do. So let's start off with the first thing I wanted to talk about, which was Helen and the fact that she lost her mask. Oh my God. I was not prepared for that. I still thought it was the ring. Like, that was the only thing that I could think of that it was that she had that was the star. Like, I thought that from last book, honestly. I forgot to mention that, but I thought that that was like a piece of the star. Like, when he gave it to her, I was like, oh my gosh, Helen's got a piece of the star, no doubt. But in this book, she did have a piece of the star, and it wasn't the fucking ring, it was her goddamn mask. I was not prepared for that. I felt like so betrayed. I felt so betrayed. I was like, no. Like, I'm scared of the Nightbringer. I'm scared of the djinn because they have been so massively wrong. And the thing is I can't not justify him releasing them because they don't deserve to be imprisoned. But at the same time, it's like, it's kind of like when you release someone from death row or from being in prison for a while. Like, if you just release them, like, they have so much mental trauma that they have to deal with. And like, you can't just release them and not deal with that mental trauma. I think that's one of the problems with our prison system. But anyways, they really need help with that mental trauma because they've been locked up for so long. And so I'm curious to see how that's going to affect the djinn going forward in the next book, because could you imagine just being locked up for like thousands of years, going insane? Like, solitary confinement literally drives people insane. There are studies. So anyways, I think that is terrible, and I can't not justify the Nightbringer releasing them, but at the same time, they're going to need so much help, or else they're not going to be what they once were. So I'm hopeful that they can get help that they need in the next book. I'm hopeful that things work out for everyone involved in the next book, because I don't think the Djinn are bad. I don't think the Nightbringer is bad. I do not think that anyone is really bad. I think people are just trying to protect their people, and it comes at the expense of others. And so it's just a tough call to make. And so I'm so excited for where this is going to go in the next book, because holy shit, like this is such a great setup. This is such a great setup where I don't know who to root for. I mean, don't get me wrong, I love Lya, but like, I can't not say that the Djinn don't deserve to be free. So now let's talk about Cook for a second. So Cook died, and Cook was Lya's mother, which I was not expecting again. I loved how the Djinn kind of used that to torment Lya a little bit. I loved how Lya was able to understand why Cook killed her daughter and her father. And I loved how Cook was kind of okay with dying because of all of that. Like, I honestly loved Cook's story. I think we got so much development with her. I think that she was just such a tough woman, and she was put in a tough position, and she had to change a lot, and I loved that she did change in the ways that she did. I think that she was just such a great character in this book, and I'm sad to see her go, but I also think that she had a great end. Like, she went out really well to me. Like, I loved how she went out. It felt very admirable, and it honestly made me tear up, because I loved how she went out. So next, let's talk a little bit about Lya and Alais. So as always, I really do enjoy their little relationship scenes that we get, even though they are so few. I love the scene where Lya and Alais, they were like in the inn together, and Alais realized that he shouldn't be there, and I just love that scene. Thought it was so, I don't know, it was just such a call to a happy time that they're never gonna have, because Alais had to literally drop his entire humanity, which was depressing. Like, that also made me cry so much, because like, I couldn't imagine giving up who I am and everything that I am, because maybe I'm a narcissist, but I do genuinely think that I'm a cool person. Like, I like myself, okay? I know not everyone does, but I like myself most days. And thing is I just couldn't imagine giving that up. I couldn't imagine giving up the book characters that I love. I couldn't imagine giving up the people that I love. I can't believe I just put book characters in front of actual people. It's fine. So anyways, I just couldn't imagine giving up everything that makes me me, you know? And so him giving that up, it was just such a tough call again. And I absolutely love him for that. I think that that is part of what shows his development so much in this book as well. He, you know, he didn't have a lot to start off with. And so everything that he did have, he seemed pretty attached to it. And so being able to give that up for others, I just thought was such a great moment for him. I think that that really made him shine in this book to me. It's part of why I actually really loved his plotline in this book. Rather than him being poisoned, he was, you know, the soul catcher, and that's what kept him apart. And the thing is that forced him to change. And so I just love how he changed in this book. I love everything about Lya. Lya, I also really enjoyed her story. I enjoyed her coming to terms with the fact that she is going to be a leader. Like, she did not want this in any way, shape, or form, but she is now claiming it. She is going to save her people, and I love it. I absolutely love how her story ended in this book, with her speaking with Helen, speaking with Livia about ending the slavery. Like, that was what I thought was fantastic, and how she was going to have the scholars help, and how that was going to be, you know, something that they could all bond over. And I loved that. I loved her story in this book. I loved how she is just coming into her own. She is also letting go of some of her attachments. She let go of Elias in this book, and I think that that is going to make her so much stronger in the next book. And I'm so curious to see if they are going to come back together or if they're not. Because at this point, although I do love those scenes that we've gotten with them being in a relationship, I almost don't know if I want them to end in one. Because this book has really set them apart so much in my mind, and I love how apart they've been set. And I love how on their own they have been able to accomplish so many different things, and how there is nothing to hold them back right now. So I just am so excited to see where that's gonna go in the next book. So next, let's talk a little bit about Musa and the princess. These are the new characters I was talking about that I was a little disappointed that we didn't get more from, because I loved Musa, okay? When Musa first was introduced, I was like, you know what? maybe I might ship Lion and Musa for a little bit. Then I realized he was like 10 years older than her because of one line. And then I was like, just kidding. But Musa is married to the princess of the Free People. And I was like, what? I think that he's still into her. I genuinely think that he's still into her. I think that they are going to end up together. I think we got to get the goals away from her, but I don't know if that's going to happen. So I'm hopeful that we can do that and then they can get together and she can be like an actual good person and not a bitch. But right now, she's a bitch. So I'm curious to see what's going to happen there. Like, I absolutely loved the little bits that we got there. And so that's kind of why I wanted more from them. I wish that we had kind of followed them a little bit after we had actually left them Lyle-wise so that we could have a theory that they were gonna come back in the next book. I still think they are because you cannot just leave it at that, Saba. But you know, we'll see what happens. I really hope to see them again. The prophecy, I also loved that. Again, I said that earlier, but I love the prophecy. I loved how every little bit, we got it explained to us how it kind of came to fruition, but at the same time, you could kind of see how it came to fruition beforehand. You just had to kind of be a little smarter. So I love the prophecy. I loved how it was kind of not very exact, but at the same time, it was so much more specific than other prophecies we get in other books. Like, this was not just like, this one made sense. It's not like you could just apply it to anything. But when it talked about the ghost in the prophecy and the ghost was Cook, I was like, oh my god. Makes so much sense. Makes so much sense. Poor Cook, man. She was a great character. So next, let's talk about how the capital fell. I was not prepared for that at all. I did not see that coming, and I think that that is what's going to set up these people for kind of a change in the future so that they don't, you know, keep slaves. Slavery bad. Why is that so hard for people in like fantasy worlds to understand? Slavery bad. But I am so excited to see how this is going to change the Marshalls. I think it's going to force them to kind of realize how they've been treating others because they are now going to be forced to be kind of treated similarly, you know? So I'm just excited to see what's gonna happen there. Next, let's talk a little bit about Livia and her pregnancy. I loved that. I loved that whole plot twist, okay? I loved how she was pregnant. I loved how she had the kid. I loved how Lyle was there to help produce the kid. I mean, birth. Anyways, Lyle was there to help birth the child. And I thought that was such a great addition to the story. I loved the whole midwife thing, how they could not find a freaking midwife and how the commandant had like killed them all, save one of them who she had then tried to make the baby come earlier. I loved it. I loved the whole thing there. And I loved how it felt like such a red herring. Like, it didn't at the time feel like a red herring, but now that I am looking back on it, it was such a red herring as far as what she was doing because this was never her goal. The Empire was actually never her goal. And so I loved that. I loved the commandant. I loved how the Empire wasn't her goal. I loved how we realized how she really wants world domination. Like, she wants to be Hitler. Like, that is her goal. Not a great goal in my mind, but you know, you do you, boo. So I'm excited to see her go down in the next book because oh boy, was she just a bad person. I loved how she tried to kill Livia and I loved how Livia didn't die. I just think that overall the commandant actually accomplished some things in this book. I loved it. Livia, I loved her character. I love how she is against slavery. Thank the good Lord we have a freaking marshal who is against slavery. So I'm excited to see where she's gonna go in the next book. So I think either Helen is gonna become Empress or Livia is gonna become Empress. Maybe Helen stays Bloodstrike. That actually sounds more realistic than Helen leading. Even though I kind of want Helen to lead at this point because I feel like she has just gone through so much and she understands so much. So next let's talk a little bit about the Nightbringer and Helen. So the whole time I kind of knew that Helen had a piece of the star. Like it made sense. I was like, why is the Nightbringer just hanging out with her? He doesn't just hang out with people unless he's trying to get something. So he's trying to get the piece of star from her. And I love how he's just trying to build her trust. And it's not really about forming that loving relationship because that's not really Helen's style. Like she is kind of cold. Like she is not someone who just loves easily or trusts easily. And so for him, it's really about building that trust. And so I loved how that's what they were doing. And I loved how at the end, the Nightbringer left her. And I was like, oh my God. I was so scared. I was like, Helen's not gonna die. You can't kill Helen. And she didn't die, but I did like seriously cry when the Nightbringer left her because I was like, I know you're not a good creature right now, but like, I didn't, like, I'm just the Nightbringer. I love him as a villain. Because it's like, is he a villain? And then lastly, I wanted to talk a little bit about Harper and Helen. They are forming a little bit of a relationship. I am enjoying it. I didn't think I would at first, but I think I'm starting to understand Harper a little bit more. I think he's starting to kind of make a little bit more sense to me. And overall, I just like that Harper is finding something to, you know, give her some feelings, because she is just so cold, and I like to see her warm up to someone. I also liked how her and Harper ended, where she was like, I can't get into this right now because I need to be a leader. I need to be someone who is thinking clearly. I cannot have these distractions. So I loved how she kind of had to put that in perspective. And I love how that is what is forcing them apart. It's not that they necessarily can't be together, that Helen knows what she needs to do. And so I love that she is not willing to put herself above others anymore. You know, she is not putting her happiness above others. She knows that she now needs to fill a role, and so she cannot fill that role with Harper, and so she cannot be with him. And so I love that that shows so much growth for her. She is putting aside her wants, her needs, so that she can best serve her people, she can best help, and do what she can to get back the capital, get back the empire, and just save a bunch of people from the commandant and her evilness. So that is my thoughts of A Reaper at the Gates by SABAA TAHIR. So if you like this video, please like, subscribe, comment, all that jazz. What are your thoughts on An Ember in the Ashes, A Torchance of the Night, A Reaper at the Gates, you know, the whole series so far? Are you excited for A Sky Beyond the Storm? Because I cannot wait to pick that book up. I will see you in my next video. Bye!